Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome back to the Formula One Aerodynamic webinar. Very happy to be back here for our third and last session. Today we are going to talk about overtaking maneuvers and mainly cornering, so aerodynamic of the car in during the corners. But to start with, just the agenda of the day. I'm going to talk to you about the F1 SimStar competition, which is something that we've launched for you to interact next week. I'm going to do an introduction about overtaking and cornering in Formula One. We'll do a live processing in ParaView, like we've done before, for the third and last case. We'll watch a video and with the slices, and then we'll have your questions and answers. So I think the questions again will take even maybe a bit more time than last time. It's really nice to be able to answer your questions. Please don't hesitate to start posting your questions. I'm happy to answer anything related to the car design. Obviously, I can show you in NX some details. And then obviously aerodynamics around the car. I'll try to answer as many questions as I can. So to start with, remember if you come on simscale.com/F1, this is where you can access the simulations that we've been talking about. Today is the third one, so Open Simulation will allow you to go and download the results. So you'll have to log in into your account. You'll have to switch to the simulation tab. I'm not going to do it here. Click on the start button, and you also find instructions on this page on the simscale.com/F1. If you're lost, you can always find some resources here. So new this week, we are launching a little bit of a race for fun. So you can become the next F1 SimStar. So the idea is that we've got until Sunday next week, so the 12th of July, to post three pictures of post-processing in ParaView using the simulation cases that we've been looking at together. So everything is explained on this page. It's very simple. You can send your images using this email address, f1@simscale.com, or on Twitter. Don't forget to read the rules here. What are you going to win? Well, there's for the first place, there's a SimScale professional training, which is a package provided by SimScale if you're very good to get more into CFD and using the SimScale platform. For the first place, also the F1 Aero package. So we've put together this couple of books here, very interesting. This model of the Mercedes F1 car. So very nice price indeed for the first, for the winner of the competition. Second to fifth place will win the professional training as well, which has got a value of £500, €500. We will have a little jury to decide who's the winner. I will be part of it, as well as David, Managing Director at SimScale, and Milad. So we are looking forward to receiving your nice pictures. Be as creative as you like, and we'll try and find who won the competition. And these pictures will be posted as well on the website. So quite exciting and a bit of fun. Okay, so let's get into the subject of the day, the overtaking and the cornering with an F1 car and the aerodynamic implications. Right, so last time we talked about slipstreaming and following a car in a straight line to obviously gain a speed advantage. get ready for offsetting yourself and maybe overtake under braking. We've seen how much the first car will influence the second car. It's obviously very significant. But when you obviously come into the corner, you will still be affected by the car that's on the side. But what I want to talk about as well is cornering and cornering on your own. Because an F1 car is not just looking at the car running in straight line at a certain ride height, but looking at what is happening in a corner and how the car is moving and how are we going to study the aerodynamics during the corner phase is critical. It's one of the main advancements in Formula One design over the last 15 years, to really go from looking at the car in a straight line to looking at the car in a corner and optimize the downforce of the car going through the corner and not just in a straight line condition. Okay, if we look at the corner phase, corner sequence here, obviously you've got the braking zone here, and then you're gonna have the corner entry phase, which is off brakes and off throttle for a little bit of time up to the apex, and then on throttle acceleration. The first thing we want to look at is what is happening with the ride height of the car during this corner phase. And again, we've talked about it last time. Ride height is one of the prime parameters in aerodynamic performance, specifically the front ride height. We discussed how if you lower the front, you gain a lot of downforce from your front wing and the floor as well. So let's look at the front and rear ride height sequence during a corner. On this plot here, you have two axes. The front ride height is this axis, and the vertical axis is the rear ride height. So coming from a straight line, your car is at maximum speed and the front and rear ride heights are at their lowest. So this is this point here. As I said before, the front ride height will actually be minimum, so the car will touch and you see the spar coming off the touching the plank at the front of the car. And the rear ride height will be really low as well. Not as low as the front, so the car is not touching at the rear unless it's very bumpy and it can happen. But this is the condition that we call maximum speed, minimum ride height condition. So it's one of the points that we will want to simulate the car at. But look at what happens when you go into a corner. So when you're going under braking, very quickly your rear ride height is going up, as you will expect. And the front ride height is going up slightly as well, much less than the rear, for two reasons. First, the front is much stiffer than the rear, so the front moves less than the rear anyway, but also because of the braking, you've got this weight transfer effect. So that will remove some weight off the back of the car, and the car is just going up in the air at the back. But the front is still going a little bit higher because of the speed reduction and the downforce at the front decreasing. Then we are going into the entry phase, so the speed decreasing. This is the yellow arrow up to the apex of the corner where we reach the maximum ride height, front and rear. This is purely because of the minimum speed that we reach around the track in this corner at the apex. So the downforce created is minimum, therefore the front is up in the air at the front and rear. Going back on throttle, green arrow, this is pushing the back end to go down quickly, and the front as well with speed increasing. And as you increase speed into the straight line, you go back to your original point here. What is critical to understand here is, as you can see, the car is moving a lot throughout the corner. And not only through a sort of a linear movement, but it's got like this hysteresis into the right high sequence that you have to go through as well in your CFD and your wind tunnel study to make sure you understand what happens with the downforce reducing, increasing throughout the phases, and more importantly, where is the center of pressure? Where is the what is the aero balance of the car during the braking, entry, exit phase? And that will affect obviously the handling of the car. I've put here a number of points, and you can see that creates an array of possibilities of ride heights that you will want to test. It's really difficult to think that you can test all of these points in CFD or even in a wind tunnel. It would take too much time, so you have to select which ride heights you will want to test. And as I said before, this is something that's been really increasing over the last 10 years in Formula One, going into the details of the cornering sequence in CFD and wind tunnel development. Ride height is not the only thing that changes during a corner. Obviously, the steering angle is another. And it's why is it so important for aerodynamics? Well, the front wheel angle is critical to aerodynamic performance of the car. F1 being an open wheel car, it's even more important than in, for example, a Le Mans type closed bodywork car. So this is again something we need to look at when we develop the car. Again, it's not just about making sure you've got as much downforce as you can in straight ahead condition. You need to make sure you don't lose that downforce when you turn the wheels. It's as simple as that. So again, we will have to link this with the ride heights and the ride height map that we've just seen and decide which steering angle we want to test the car in conjunction with the ride heights points that we want to test at. The wheel can turn up to maybe 20 degrees if you're going to a very slow corner like Monaco. So you can imagine the effect on the aerodynamics. And to do this test, you will need to simulate a complete, a full car in CFD, obviously. Now, steer angle is not the only thing that is changing during the corner. Roll angle is another one. So I've put a couple of pictures. In the corner, the car is rolling. Obviously, you can. It's easy to understand with the G-force and the center of gravity of the car being probably 200 millimeters above the ground. So that creates a rotation of the chassis on the tires and on the suspension. Now, this angle is not very big in Formula One because the car is very stiff. It's still up to a couple of degrees. And we'll do the tests. I hope in the future you can see in CFD it's significantly affecting the aerodynamics of the car again. So this is another parameter to look at. And the last one is what we call yaw angle. So I've taken this picture from probably 30, 40 years ago. It's easier to see it on these pictures, but what happens these days on the modern cars is exactly the same. The cars are sliding around the corner. On these pictures, the angle of sliding is obviously very very high, probably 25 degrees here. And that's because just the nature of the tires at the time. These days, the angle of sliding is more like 5 or 10 degrees, not more, because of the nature of the tires in Formula One. So it's not so obvious from the eye and on TV that the cars are sliding, but they are. And that creates a yaw angle between the wind in the wind tunnel or on track, obviously, and the car. And this angle can be as high as 5 or 10 degrees. So I've put on this picture here, I've put a yaw angle of a straight wind coming to the car. Now if you go a bit further and understand that the car is actually is rotating on itself. So the chassis has got a yaw velocity. If you would look at the car from the top, you would see it rotates about its vertical axis. And that is the yaw velocity of the car. So you can imagine that the angle of the wind is affected by the yaw velocity. So in reality, the real condition of the wind, and I've put it here in brackets, is called a curved wind. The wind is actually curved around the car. A little bit like this light blue arrow here. This will effectively reduce the angle of the wind relative to the front wing of the car to sometimes back to 0 degrees, but keep a high angle at the back so that the wind will still have 5 to 10 degrees angle with the rear wing. Now, this is not easy to simulate in a wind tunnel, as you can imagine, because the wind is obviously going in a straight line. There has been some studies and mechanisms put in place to curve the wind in a wind tunnel, yes. But it's quite heavy and difficult to do. But in the CFD, we can do it more easily. But it's sort of a higher degree of fidelity, and it's we have first to look at the ride height, the steer angle, the roll angle, then the yaw angle. If you put the curvature of the wind, which will depend on the corner that you're looking at, that adds a lot of complexity. But I want just to make sure that we understand that these things are looked at in the Formula One development process. For us at this stage, we haven't even looked at yaw angle in the simulations that we've done. The wind was straight to the car. But you know, developing our cars forwards, we will look at yaw, curved wind potentially as well. So these are all the parameters that we need to take into account when we develop the cars in CFD and the wind tunnel. Right, so let's move on to ParaView now. I'm going to start ParaView and do a last live processing of the third simulation for you. A little bit of a repeat of what we've done last week, but never mind. Right, I'm trying to find the file here. Simulation 3. Okay, so the file is not here in my case. I'm going to go back to simulation 2 and do simulation 2 again. It doesn't matter. Simulation 2 and 3 are very similar. It's just the distance of the car that is changing. So let's do it this way. Select everything here. Don't forget to go to time number 1 and apply. So that's going to load the case. It's going to take 10-15 seconds. I just want to check. Okay, so the video is ready for us later. Still loading. If you don't see anything, click on the eye here. Okay. So I do the post-processing again quickly. just for those who have missed it before, and refresh refresh everyone. Okay, so remember we want to isolate both cars. So case.foam filter, and we want to extract block. First, we want to extract the first car. Okay, and then we do the same for the second car. Perfect. Remember, it's always easier to look at parallel projection here. When you zoom, it's just a bit easier. Okay. Last thing is we want to change the scale, so we go back to rescale here, and we want 1,800 minus 3,600. And again, this is to get back to the color scheme that you are used to. All we do in Formula One when we develop, it's like any athlete, you know, practicing is doing the same again and again. So you want the format and the color scheme to always be the same, so you can notice differences, and that's how you progress better. So always be careful with your scale. Make sure it fits what you are used to. Perfect. One thing I want to do is to do this is to mirror the second car so we can have a good look at the differences between the two. So if I take the second car, select it here, and I'm gonna do a reflect about Y max in this case. Perfect. So if I do a front view of this, this is actually the easiest way to look at the following a car and the effect on the second car. It's very clear here, the difference in coloring left to right, the effect, so the first car is on the right hand side, second car is on the left hand side, and it's very easy to see the difference in static pressure on the wings. Front wing, static pressure on the front tire. I didn't show that picture before, but I think this is the easiest way to study this specific case. Okay, and the last thing that we normally do is a slice. Let's do it quickly. Don't forget to select case.foam to slice the complete domain. Do a slice, show plane, I normally deselect it, origin will be 0, 0, 0, and we want it about the y-axis, apply. Okay. And we want this slice to be colored by velocity. So go to the drop-down menu, velocity, and the last thing, as I said, go back to the scale that you are used to for velocity, in this case 60, between 0 and 60 is easier for us. Here you go. And zoom. So we've seen this before. Obviously, the third simulation is the same with the car is slightly further rearwards relative to the first car. Okay, so I'm going to stop ParaView here, and again, you can ask your questions if you like. And the last thing we are going to look at is this video. It's what we've seen before, but just going through it again. One more time. So we are looking at velocity in the flow and the direction of the flow as well, using the LIC visualization in the domain. And this is the nose of the front car. Going through the first car. Look at how strong all these vorticity is, all this rotational flow around the first car. Moving further forwards. Rearing of the first car, and then going towards the second car. So in this video, the second car is has got more of a distance to the first car. So we are still in the flow between both cars. And now is the second car. Because the second car in this case is a bit further behind the first car, you can see that the flow is recovering some of its velocity and energy, but you still have a lot of slower flow in front of the front wing of the second car. We talked last week about the flow going outside, the flow cooling the brakes. You can see it going outside through the wheel. It's quite clear here on this picture. And if I come back a little bit, okay. You can see that the rotational flow we've seen on the first car is completely different here. Effect from the first car on the second car again. Here we go. So, up to you now. If you have questions, I'd be more than happy to answer them. Because it's the last workshop, we can spend a little bit more time on questions. So, Milad, up to you. Ready to answer the questions that you can select for me, please.
Yes, Nick, thank you very much. There are a lot of questions, and I will directly start with the first one. Just 1 second. Yes. The first question is, what is the difference for the car behind in the simulation you just showed us now, where the distance is higher? How the way it is influenced by the car in front change?
Okay. Yes, we can see on these pictures, it's easier to see. By the way, I think this picture should be swapped, but never mind. But it's just to illustrate. So one car is very close to the first one in this case. In the second scenario, the distance is higher. You can basically, it will just change how much of an effect the wake has got on the second car. When we looked at the first car being very close to the second car being very close to the first car, the effect is huge. And we said that downforce and drag could be reduced as much as 50% for the second car. When the distance is higher, the effect is simply smaller. And I think it would take probably 10 car lengths, something like this, to start to have a very, very small effect. So 10 car lengths is a good 30 meters, 40 meters, or even 50 meters before you start to reduce the slipstream effect. You would still have an effect. You know, it takes some time for the air to settle down.
Great, thank you. Next question is by Essen, and his question is, What is the effect of converging the flow between the diffuser, beam wing, and rear wing?
Okay. So first of all, the beam wing, we don't have a beam wing anymore. Doesn't matter. I can explain. If I slice the car, about the y-axis like this. So we've got our diffuser profile here, we've got our rear wing profile here, and there used to be up to 2 years ago, I think, yeah, 3 years ago, there used to be the beam wing, and the beam wing was another sort of smaller rear wing in the middle. But the rules have changed, and the box in which you can design the car has changed, so you cannot have any beam wing anymore. But they used to work together with the beam wing. There was an interaction between them. There's not as much of an interaction anymore because the distance between the rear wing and the floor is very high now. But with the beam wing, you used to have quite a big interaction. So by that, I mean that you can imagine the beam wing was there, and the suction of the beam wing, the underside suction of the beam wing, was helping the diffuser to work better. Was sucking the diffuser and making the diffuser work harder. It was also helping the rear wing to not detach. To not stall. So remember, the rear wing is one of the most difficult elements on the wing now to keep attached. So by that I mean the flow needs to follow the curvature of the wing, and it's quite difficult without the beam wing to keep this flow attached, purely because the beam wing used to, with the higher pressure on top of the beam wing, that higher pressure used to push a little bit under the main rear wing and keep the flow attached, but it's not there anymore. So this is what we call interaction between wings when you put them one on top of the other, and the diffuser is a wing as well, so it works the same way. But it's not as strong anymore because the beam wing is not there anymore. Okay.
Okay, Nick, thank you again. Next question is from Bruno. Bruno wants to ask you if there are any effects worth mentioning when overtaking, more specifically, the moment the car gets out of the slipstream. He self-rides bicycle, he also rides, and when he overtakes after getting out of the slipstream, it feels like he would hit a brick wall and loses a bit of stability even.
Yes, well, if you get out of the slipstream, you go back into the mainstream. So you can imagine that you go from downforce level of 50% of what you had and drag as well, to back to 100% very quickly. So that creates an oscillation. It doesn't come smoothly. It will create an oscillation purely because if you push again harder on the car, the suspension oscillates, and also the flow has to. It takes a little bit of time for the flow to stabilize. That's what we call the car length of flow. If you imagine the flow has to go from the front to the back of the car, and how many car lengths will it take for the flow to sort of settle? So this is the kind of oscillation and disturbance you get. It's fairly short in time, but you do get it. So if you go back into the mainstream at the end of the straight line just before braking, you have to be careful to not do it too late, because if you're into this sort of oscillation mode while you get on your brakes, it can be disturbing. But I don't think it's too difficult. I don't think this effect is too big neither. So maybe on the bicycle it's it's got a bigger effect because the bicycle is lighter. I don't know, but anyway, yes, there is a little bit of an effect.
There's something else Bruno wants to know. Is this could maybe be the reason why Maldonado lost control and crashed in the last race?
Maldonado crashed. Well, that happens quite often anyway. the reason for the crash, I don't know, and I don't think I've seen that crash, so it's hard for me to comment on it specifically. But we've seen in the past some crashes where, yes, a car was following another one, and there is some car that, you know, you move quickly off the slipstream, and you just have to settle the car again. You have to remember these cars are always on the edge, and then when you go under braking, you're on the edge of locking your wheels as well. So, yes, if you're in the disturbance of another car, you know, it can explain maybe losing control.
Okay, Nick, I can just remember, you know, the crash Mark Webber had, I think, 1998 in Le Mans. I think it was also because of the aerodynamics. Anyways, next question is Bakram. And oh, it's a very long question. Okay, so he asks, when we simulate a car in straight line, it's clear what we need to investigate. But for the cornering, what are the most critical points that we need to investigate? For example, if we talk about the Y250 vortex in the straight line, it's clear that we want this vortex to go outboard to push the front tire wake underboard. But for cornering, how unique this vortex looks like, as the vortex will be destroyed.
Okay. I'm going to actually do live a little graphic trying to explain what we're trying to achieve when we develop the car in cornering. Hopefully it's going to be quick. It's going to be very quick. So, okay. What we want to achieve is to make sure that between a straight ahead condition and a cornering condition, we don't lose too much downforce. We will always lose. So if you plot, if you do a quick plot of your downforce versus your angle, for example, I do it here, up, done. Okay, so the highest point of downforce will always be achieved when your car is straight ahead. Purely because you tend to develop the car most of the time in a straight ahead condition to reduce the drag, and this is the way you start, so you tend to have a highest point of downforce when the U is zero. So, you know, if I go, okay, so imagine this is straight ahead, and then when you go into corners, left or right, you lose downforce. Because your yaw angle increases, your steer angle increases, your roll angle increases, and all these parameters are detrimental to the aerodynamics. So you lose downforce. But what you try and do is develop a car that is going to be a little less sensitive to cornering. So for the same straight ahead performance, you try and make a car that is less sensitive to cornering. So you can see the curve is shallower. So when you go in cornering, you lose a little bit less downforce. For the same, imagine it's the same straight ahead downforce, like this. And that makes a better car. It's a car less sensitive, so during the cornering phase, it will be more stable. The downforce will be the platform. The driver sometimes call about the platform is more stable. This is what they're saying, is that the downforce level doesn't change as much going in and out a corner. And now the reason for always losing downforce is, well, because the Y250 vortex for example, is moving. So if I go back to the video here, and I go back to the first car, okay. This is the first car. I want to move. Okay, so I go back to just after the front wing. You can see the Y250 vortex here and there. If you go into a corner, it would shift left to right. So if you go into, if you put a U-angle into one direction, this Y250 vortex will go outboard, and this Y250 vortex will go inboard. So you're left in this, in an asymmetrical situation. So that's why you will lose downforce, because you cannot optimize both sides of the car at the same time. The flow is not the same on both sides of the car. When you were in a straight line condition, the car, the flow was symmetrical. So you can imagine that by developing the car, you achieve maximum downforce both sides of your car. And you will never design a car that is not symmetrical geometrically. It doesn't make sense. Unless you're going around an oval always on the left-hand side, like in America. But for Formula One, you want a symmetrical car geometrically. So when you go in a corner, the flow is not symmetrical. Therefore, one side of the car is going to lose more downforce than the other. Overall, you will lose downforce. This is what, this is the mechanism behind. But coming back to this plot here, you still want to develop the car such that it is not as sensitive. There is also the discussion about, should we have a car that is less sensitive to cornering? But as you can see, the straight ahead downforce has reduced. So if you average the downforce, it will probably be the same for both cars, but one car will be more stable than the other. This is actually most of the time what happens. If you want a less sensitive car to cornering, you will lose your peak, will reduce. The fastest car is somewhere between these two, so you have to also go into a simulator and see which car will be best. You can understand the level of complexity we are looking at. You know, just today going into the cornering discussion, you know, the complexity of aerodynamic development becomes even higher. I hope that answers a little the question. It's a complicated one, I guess.
Yes, absolutely, but very interesting. Emanuele has a very good question, or maybe it's more not a question. I think we showed the wrong simulation, not the wrong, but there's also simulation. You would like to see the simulation of the video you presented today. Would that be possible? With a bigger where you have the bigger distance between the cars.
Yes. To be honest, it's only because it was not downloaded, so I would need to download it now and open it.
Okay. I think that would take some time.
Yes. I think the process in Paraview is exactly the same. So I invite you to, you know, to open it in Paraview and go through exactly the same process. It will just, the flow will just be a little different. But I think it's something you could do at home. It would be interesting.
Yes, and a good first step for our competition. And if you have any problems or questions, just send an email to support@simscale.com. Okay, I hope that's fine for you. Next question by Tim. Tim asks, is the vortex running beside the car floor pulling air from under the car, or is it adding to the air under the car?
Okay. So the vortex, well, first the Y250 vortex, coming back to the Y250 vortex, we've talked about it a lot, but again, it is such a strong driver of performance in Formula One. We need to talk about it. For example, this Y250 vortex, if I go here, it rotates, this way. So anti-clockwise in this case, okay, anti-clockwise. So what it does is it draws air from the top down in the center of the car. So yes, it will add some air going under the floor, and then it will also push the lower air inboard to the outboards. That helps to wash out the wake of the tire. So if I move a little bit forwards, this blue here behind the front tire, the white 50 vortex is helping pushing it away. So that has that's a second benefit. So the first benefit is drawing some air under the floor, in the center of the car, and then washing away the air outboard. We have it again because the regulation says that we need a front wing that has got this shape. So the vortex is here, and we work with it. It is not that the car has been developed with the white 50 vortex by choice. Everybody's got it because of the regulation. So you need to just work with it and take the positive of it and adapt your car to it. But if I carry on a little bit through the car, so again, we won't see it here because the white 50 vortex is weak on this car at this point. Normally it should be stronger still, and some flow should be drawn under the floor here. And then if you carry on, you see other vorticity created. This one comes off the edge of the floor, and so this one is rotating this way and is helping to draw some air on the side of the car, from the side of the car to the diffuser area. So yes, using this rotational flow, you're pushing some air in the areas that you like. Okay.
There are some more questions. Alberto wants to know, would increasing the width of the cars make overtaking more difficult, or would it depend on the increase of the width of the neutral section of the front wing?
I've read somewhere that they're talking about increasing the width of the car for 2017, I think. I think the way it's going to work, probably if you take the car as it is now, I think they want to increase the width of the tires. So they probably leave the wheels where they are and just increase the tire width on the outboard side. So the car becomes wider, but actually nothing is changing in the middle of the car. The only change would be the tire going wider, front and rear, I think, or maybe rear only. As for the floor, I don't know. It depends what they want to widen. But I think potentially it will make overtaking a little bit more difficult, purely because if the car is wider, first of all, you have less space to go into when you try and overtake. And also the wake of the car might be a bit bigger, so when you follow in the corner, you might lose a bit more downforce. But this has to be seen. Maybe it won't be the case. It depends what other geometrical changes they will want to apply. I don't think there's only one answer to this question, to be honest. Personally, I don't think the cars should go wider purely because from an efficiency point of view, we've been looking at using less fuel. If you look at Le Mans, for example, the car have gone a little bit narrower. I think it's a little bit more, it is the way the modern cars are going. But this is only an opinion.
Yes, that's a good point, Nick. Next question is by Junaid. He asks, any downside to using wishbones as the wings for aero devices?
Yes, that's a good question. There's always this discussion in the Formula One teams when we design, should we use the wishbone as an aerodynamic device? Should we use it to help us, so make it bigger and use it as a wing? Or should we make it as small as possible to make sure it doesn't have an effect and it doesn't create any drag? Well, I think there's two different philosophy, and some people like it one way, some people like it another way. If I do a section on the car, we have at the moment the wishbone sections I have put here are pretty small, as you can see. relative to certain other cars you can see on in F1. Some people have it small as this. I don't think you can go much smaller because it has to be strong enough anyway. But you can have it much bigger. But if you have it longer chord, so a longer section, you will have it also thicker because there is a ratio that you need between the chord and the thickness. So it will also be thicker and bigger. So is it better one way or another? I think it depends on where you look, front or rear. For example, at the rear, in this case, I haven't done it, but this is the toe link at the back, and it's placed exactly behind the drive shaft here, strategically. So effectively, the flow is only going through one section instead of three sections because they're hiding each other. Well, I think making the toe link bigger could be potentially better because you're closing the gap to the drive shaft and make it a little bit more like one big wing. And you can do the same for this wishbone here. So in this case, we could look at making the sections bigger. This is something we would test in CFD and keep it if it's better or not keep it if it's worse. But as for this is the pull road. So you know that at the back, it's a pull road and not a push road. This has to have a round section because of its nature. So you want this as small as possible because the round section is not going to be really nice for the flow. So this has to be small. And for the other ones, you will test big and small and look at what's best. There's another rule saying the angle of attack of each leg has to be plus or minus 5 degrees maximum. So in some places, you will find that you cannot really put the angle of attack that you like to align it to the flow, for example. And therefore, it's better to make a smaller section so it has a smaller incidence, negative incidence in that case. So you have to, you really have to look at them one by one is my answer. And try small and big and different angle of attack and make your decisions. And you can actually see on the cars that are at Silverstone today, some people have got them big, some people have got them small. So there's not one answer, you have to try them. Okay?
Great. There are some more cool questions, and one of them is, sorry, a little bit, yes, it's again by Tim. He wants to know what are the fundamental design differences between LMP1 and F1 cars, and if this is more than the fact that you have open wheel versus closed wheels.
Yes, effectively, this is probably the biggest difference. But there's another big difference if I look at the underside of the car. As you can see on the Formula One car, this is highlighted here. That's the floor area that you have on the F1 car. So as you can see, the floor area is not very big relative to the size of the car because there's a big hole here. There's no floor in this area. In a Le Mans car, first of all, the floor is wider, so it goes to the end, to the width of the tire, and it goes up to the front wheel as well. So all this area is a floor. And the diffuser is much bigger because it starts earlier and the size of it is bigger. So the underfloor performance and area of a Le Mans car is bigger, actually. So it does actually produce potentially more downforce. It doesn't only because we don't have the big rear wing on the Le Mans car. But what I mean is the most of the performance of a Le Mans car comes from the floor, where on the Formula One car, it's not only the floor. It's rear wing, front wing, and floor. So you've got three elements. On the LMP1 car, the floor is bigger. So that's one of the biggest difference. And we, in the future, if I'll be able to, I'll show you differences on the CFD. It will be interesting as well. Okay.
Okay, Nick. Yes. Next question is by Tanai. Also, good question related to the one of Tim. How much is the difference in the drag of an F1 car without and with DRS? And there's a second question who's asking, what is the difference on downforce between F1 and LMP1?
Okay. Let's put some quick numbers here. So, right. So L over D, that's the first number we look at, efficiency. And we said last time an F1 is between 3.5 and 4. An LMP1 is 4.5. So the ratio between downforce and drag is different, the efficiency of the car. The LMP1 is actually more efficient than the F1 car. It doesn't mean it's faster, but it is more efficient, mainly because, as I said, the floor is much bigger, and this is the most efficient aerodynamic component on the car. And also because of the Le Mans track, the nature of the track means that you want to run less drag and less downforce. And when you reduce drag and downforce, the car increases in efficiency. The F1 car would be the same. So you end up looking at, so if you look at drag and downforce separately, we said the F1 would be something around 1, when the LMP1 would be something around 0.7 roughly, and this is drag. Okay, so you can see that the LMP1 has got much less drag than the F1 car. So in terms of downforce, you can, using the ratio, you can find that number, and they will actually have a similar downforce level. So downforce similar. So this is the comparison between an F1 and an LMP1. Again, the F1 is still faster because it's got it's lighter. It's got a little bit more power as well with the V6 turbo engine. But it doesn't have as much hybrid boost. But still, I think the weight is the biggest difference, and that makes the F1 car, you know, 5 to 10 seconds faster on the same track. There you go.
Yes. Okay. Next question is by Carlos Eduardo. What is the influence in the car when doing an overtaking on a inclinated road? Inclinated, sorry.
It's difficult to answer that question. So, well, if you've got some banking effects, which actually is similar to putting the car, you know, on with an angle like this, or when you see the cars in America on the oval, they're running on the banking, and that helps them to corner faster. But as for overtaking, it's difficult to answer. You know, is it easier to overtake or not on a flat track or with some banking? I don't know. Of course, if you are banking, you will go faster anyway in the corner. But both cars will go faster, so is it easier to overtake? I don't know.
Okay, Nick. Okay. Again, a question by Akram. He wants to know what is the role of the following element of the front wing. What is the role of the following element, front wing, lower strake wing, Sorry, I don't get the question really. I think what he wants to know is yes, the role of the following element of the front wing.
Yes, so I guess the different elements on the front wing. So without going into too many details, the front wing is got four main elements to make up the main wing. I'll double click here. It's not as easy. So let's go back to the main view. Okay. I'll do it this way. So solid body. Okay. Right. So if I describe the front wing, this is the FIA section. Everybody's got the same. And it stops at white 50. And then you've got four main elements for the front wing. One, two, three, four. These will create your general, you know, downforce generated by the wing. Then you've got the foot of the end plate. So this is the end plate, this foot, and this vertical plane here. And the foot on the wing is always the end plate, or the foot in this case, has got always the same function, is to seal, is to be as close to the ground as possible and create the vorticity and the rotational flow going from over the wing to under the wing. So that increases the performance and creates some vorticity. Now you also have these upper wings here. So that's what we used to call cascade wing, I think. So in this case, three elements, cascade wing, and that's a mini end plate. And this one is, we would call it a turning vane. Turning vane. The function of these, very quickly, is first they will create a little bit of downforce locally, but more importantly, this will change the rotational flow again going to the tire. So I don't know if I have it on the picture here. Let's have a look.
By the way, okay. Akram sent me a link to a picture which is showing what it means. I just sent it to you on the chat. So.
Yeah, I think he's talking about strikes under the wing as well.
Yeah.
I'll have a look. But just to finish on this one, you can see the vane is creating a vortex here. This one will have a small one as well. And the effect of these, it's hard to see here, but they will go over the front tire and sort of clear the boundary layer. This is the theory. So they have an interaction with the tire. But what you find on other wings, front wings, is people are adding strikes under them. And I don't have them just now because this is part of the development process. You want to add them one by one and make sure they work before you design them in the first instance. So you would have strikes under the wing here, and these will control the strength of the vortex in this tunnel, and they will have individual vorticity. It's the same effect as the strike, these strikes in the diffuser. You remember we've got this one, this one, this one, this one, this one, and this one. You've got six of them. So you do the same under the wing here, and that just helps, you know, the performance of the wing. So all these features, you tend to add them one by one, and you make sure they all provide a positive. So you tend also to revisit them. So sometimes you will remove them and make sure they still provide a performance advantage. It can change with time. You know, if you change another area of the wing, you want to make sure your strike is still positive. So you want to test without and put it back in. Okay?
Thank you, Nick. Akram, did that answer your question? If not, just send me something or something in the chat. Okay, now next question by David. Could you describe the effect of the vertical plates in front of the wheel tires?
Okay. This one. So first of all, it's quite small because there's a regulation that you cannot it cannot go higher than Z100, so 100 millimeter above the ground, above the reference plane, which is this under the floor. If you look at this box here, this is a special box that we call R75 box. So everything inside this box has to be a minimum of a radius of 75 millimeters. So it has to be nice and smooth. This is to make sure that people don't put any sort of vane or small aerodynamic devices on their bodywork. This is why the bodywork is so nice and clean in this area. And that box goes down to Z100. So you can see we have this vane just under it. Now, the reason for having this vane is it's got a very strong interaction with the jet that will go off the rear tire. I think we talked a little bit about this last week, but if I go back on the video here, nearly there. Okay, so now we see the strike we're talking about. And you have to go a bit further to have the answer, but this blue jet here, it's a bit difficult to see, that's better. This blue jet here is negative. Going into your diffuser is going to lose performance. Here you go, all this blue area, this is negative for your performance in your diffuser. So you're trying to control it and make it smaller. Well, actually, that vertical strike here is exactly to do that. So I cannot demonstrate it here, but if we would remove it, you would lose performance in your diffuser because of the jet of your rear tire would change. So you have to test. You have to remove it, and you see the difference. Sometimes some teams have got two of them or three of them, smaller ones. And every little details you do in front of the rear tire is for the same reason, is for controlling the jet of your contact patch. Okay?
Okay, Nick, yes. Next question is by Nuance Bilan. That's quite funny. I really know some of you guys by the name after having three sessions. Okay, back to the question. When the driver is using the DRS, the car is reducing its drag. My question is, would be by how much is reducing its downforce?
Yes, I don't have the number here because we haven't done the test yet on this car, so I won't give you a number. But very simply, when you look at the rear wing, you have to, there is something very important about developing the F1 car, is what we call the rear wing curve. And the rear wing curve is the polar of the rear wing. So if you change the angle of the flap, for example, or if you see there's a gurney as well, here, the gurney on the flap, if you remove the gurney, and that will give you less downforce and less drag, okay? And the ratio of this delta downforce versus delta drag, this is the rear wing curve. And that's a very important slope, and that's a very important number because this is what you want to tune depending on the racetrack you go at. Remember, we talked when you go to Monaco or Monza or Barcelona, you need a different, these tracks require a different rear wing level. And this is specifically for that because the rear wing curve has to be exactly set at the right point depending on the track you go to. So the rear wing has got a slope, an efficiency. So if you open the DRS, it's exactly the same as removing the gurney, but it's even bigger in terms of an effect. But all it does is reducing downforce and drag to a ratio that is the ratio of the rear wing curve. And the rear wing curve normally is quite similar to the efficiency of the car. So, well, oh, it will be a lower number. So if I come back to these numbers, I said an F1 car has got an efficiency of 3.5 to 4, and actually the rear wing itself, rear wing L over D, will be about 1.5, something like that, which corresponds to the track required efficiency for Barcelona, okay, 1.5. So coming back to this view, if you open the flap for DRS, you will lose 1.5 of downforce for one of drag. This is the ratio of the rear wing. So it's quite an important number, because from that number you know how much downforce will be lost for how much drag. Now, how much drag itself, I need to test it on this wing to know, so I cannot give you that number, but it will be quite big. And that will help you to probably go faster by 20 km/h in a straight line, so it's quite big. Okay?
Yes, great, thank you. Okay, Junaid's next question. How effective are aero devices on Pikes Peak cars?
Pikes Peak, yeah. Let's have a look at what's the name, the Peugeot. This car. This is the car that holds the record at the moment with Sébastien Loeb. How efficient these features? So I think they took a car, they sort of put this massive front splitter, they sort of modified the side of the car so it's got a floor, they've got a big rear wing. So all these devices will be very inefficient in an aerodynamic point of view. All these numbers we were talking about, the efficiency of an F1 car, 3.5 to 4, the rear wing itself, these are actually fairly efficient numbers. But when you add these bits to a car, the efficiency of these will be very low, probably below 1. So it will add a lot of drag on the car, but also downforce. But it's the only thing you can do on these cars. You cannot really add efficient downforce. It will have to come with a lot of drag. But for this specific car, it doesn't matter because it's a hill climb, so your drag doesn't count really. You've got far enough power on these cars to accelerate, and the limitation will come purely from the tire, from the grip. So it doesn't matter to add drag to the car as long as you add downforce that helps cornering speeds. And this is why they put this sort of huge aerodynamic devices on them. But yeah, very low efficiency.
Okay. Then there are four or five questions remaining. Guys, you're still asking new questions. I think we can make the session some minutes longer. But I would say next, all the questions which are, we will only answer questions which are asked in the next 3 minutes, and then we will close the question round and just answer the questions which are already here. Great. David has again a question. What are some of the design decisions that are considered when designing the vertical turning vanes near the side pods?
Yes. So the vertical turning vanes are these ones. And if we slice the car, which we like to do, okay. So this is a vertical axis slice. Right. And you can see these vanes each side. They're quite small, but actually fairly efficient. The reason for having them is it will help the flow to follow the coke line. This is what we call the coke line. It's got like a coke, you know, a coke bottle shape. And the flow has to follow this line going towards the diffuser. And to help this flow, we add these vanes here. So they will turn the flow a little bit for us and make sure the flow follows the line here. So that's why they're here, and they're helping quite a bit to feed into the diffuser. So yeah, everybody's got them, and I think it's a fairly basic feature to have on the cars. Okay.
Great. Then Tanner has also again a question. How does the flow behave at the stagnation point on the front nose of the F1 car? Does it enter in from the small opening and leave the underbody to energize the flow underneath?
Yes, it does enter in the hole. That goes and feeds some air into the cockpit to cool the driver, to be honest, and create a little bit of flow for the driver. The hole on this nose is fairly big, actually, and it shouldn't be as big, so it's something that will change. I think on some cars now, there's not even a hole now, and there's a hole under the nose, so you can put it somewhere else. But to be honest, it's not... If you wouldn't have a hole here instead of this hole, I don't think the numbers would change a lot. So it's fairly small effect.
Okay.
Okay, Milad.
Yes, I know we're running out of time, but I think just give me a sign when you have to leave or short notice. Tim, wants to know, how does the airflow change in velocity as it goes under the floor? I think this is something we can easily see on post processing or on the images.
Yeah. Let's have a look here. So we tend to let's have a look at the first car. Okay, in this case, you can see it's red everywhere because it will be more than 60 meters a second. So let's change the scale just for this case. So the slice, and we put let's put 90, and I'll come back a little bit to 80. Okay. So the first thing is always the same. You can see at the kick of the diffuser, you can see the red here, so the air is accelerating. Always the same when you've got suction, acceleration of the flow. The same happens under the rear wing. Remember, the air is accelerating, and that's why you've got suction. So this is what happens, the same acceleration at the kick of the diffuser. But generally, you also see that the flow is quite fast, and is faster than the ambient. If I come back to the original scale, it's 60 or more meters per second everywhere. So the flow under the car is fairly fast, even so at the kick of the diffuser. Okay.
Okay, Nick. Three more questions, I think, and I will just choose, because some people asked some more questions and the first question. Okay, this is a funny question. Junaid wants to know, which car do you prefer, LaFerrari, McLaren P1 or 980 hybrid?
What was the choice again?
LaFerrari, McLaren P1 918 hybrid.
I'm not a big supercar. I'm not a big road car guy anyway. I like racing cars, so I don't think I have a preference. I'm not a very big Ferrari guy anyway. I don't know. I like the McLaren P1, maybe. That would be my preferred.
Okay, yeah, it's a nice car, but
Yeah.
maybe someday there is a road version of the Maya LMP1 also would be great.
Exactly, why not?
Okay, then Carlos Eduardo again. His next question is how it's made the balance between maximum, minimum downforce and the suspension of the car.
So, yeah, there's always a trade-off between the stiffness of your suspension and the downforce of the car. If you run your car very, very stiff, you can run it a little bit lower around the track, and so it will generate a bit more downforce everywhere. But you will reach a point where it's too stiff, and the driver cannot go on the curbs, for example. If you take a track like Monza, is a good example because you would think that you have to run the car very low and very stiff because it's a high-speed track. But one of the things with Monza is you've got very high curbs when you go into the chicanes. So it's actually one of the track when you have to run a softer suspension. So you can see there is always a compromise between aerodynamics and suspension setting. But some cars now have got systems that allow still to run stiff suspensions, but then they are a little bit clever with how they react on the curbs and feel soft on the curbs. So that is the best way to do it if you can. But these systems are a bit complicated. So there is a trade-off. You have to try on the racing track, to be honest. You have to change the springs and listen to what the driver says, and it's not always stiffer that is better in this case. More downforce, yes, but more difficult to drive. So you have to back off a little bit and maybe make a softer car.
Thank you, Nick. Jakob has a question regarding the vertical plane in front of rear wing, which were used, for example, in 2009 by Renault. What is the purpose of this big vertical planes? Like, can you give us an answer?
So 2009.
Yes.
Let's see if I can. Yes. So I think we are talking about the fin. What we call the fin. If the picture is a bit clearer, we'll see it here. Here you go. So this vertical plane. It's just the tail, sort of the tail of the engine cover is extended nearly up to the rear wing in this case. We can't do that anymore if you look at the box. We can do it up to, you can see they've added this window here where they don't allow you to extend anymore. And I think if you make it this length, it's not very effective anyway, so nobody does it. Anyway, the reason why they used to do that, it comes back to the yaw angle discussion. If you remember, car sliding in the corner, so the air has got the angle with the car, yaw angle. If you have the fin, it will stabilize a little bit the car. It will actually, the air is going to push on the fin and will tend to put the car straighter in the back, straighter in the corner. So it helps to stabilize, specifically if the car starts to slide from the rear. So this is why they have it. To be honest, and I remember testing it on the car I worked before, and it's not always it's not always obvious that it helps. It's one of these things, it's very obvious to the eye, but the effect of this, I can tell you, is much smaller than some details on the front wing sometimes. Here you go.
Okay, there are the two last questions. One is again by Akram, and he asks if you can maybe explain the role of the different type of cuts in trackers on the rear wing end plate. And you also sent us a link to a picture I will forward to you.
Well, I don't see your links, so I don't see your picture.
I sent it to you on the chat. But anyways, this...
Yes. Oh, I see. Yeah, okay. Let me see how this works. Okay. Yes. God, they make the end plates really complicated these days.
The other louvers, right?
Yeah. So you've got the louver at the top, which we have. And I said, I think last time, we have them here. What they do is efficiently reduce the rear wing performance. So it reduces the drag and the downforce, but in an efficient way. So the drag reduction will be a bit more than the downforce reduction. So that's one thing. There is a slot on the leading edge here that appeared sort of 2 years ago, and everybody's got it now. And that helps the air to turn and come in between the end plates. The air is coming from the outside and turning inside between the end plates, and sometimes it's a little bit sharp. So if you put this slot, it helps to turn, makes it a little bit cleaner. You've got louvers at the back here, and that's because the flow coming off the diffuser wants to go outboard very quickly, so it goes through these louvers. So that's the flow off the diffuser. And then you've got some fins here at the end of the end plate. I think one of the reasons they put them here is to stiffen up the end plate, because the end plate is very thin in this area for aerodynamic reasons, but then it tends to be a little bit flimsy, a little bit soft. So this actually helps to stiffen up. It's like a rib. Stiffen up your end plate again. So it's not so much aerodynamic, it's a little bit structural. So I don't think they will have a big aerodynamic effect. It's mainly to stiffen up the end plate. Okay?
Okay, now the last question. I'm not sure, I think you talked about the last workshop, or the first workshop, but Michael wants to know, is there any special reason why the front wings were so simple, the shape was so simple 3 or 4 years ago, and now they are so complex? Is it just because of regulations, or?
Well, and I'm glad it's the last question, because it comes back to exactly what we are doing here when we develop a car. It's not by regulation. You know, back in 2010, you could design much more complex front wings. But it was the start of the new regulation era that started in 2009. So nobody would start from a complicated front wing at the beginning, because you don't know what you need. So as an engineer, when you start on a new project like this in 2010, you have to start simple so you don't get lost. And you only do one step at a time. And look at what happens 5 years later. The front wing is much more complicated. It will be also much better in performance compared to the more simple front wing. But you don't achieve the complicated front wing the first time. You can't. You have to evolve it. So it's an evolution process. And I'm really glad we can say that at the end. So just to say to everyone, to start a design, we are going to evolve the Perrin F1 car as well, so you will see how it works. It's an evolution process. It's not coming out with a complicated looking car to start with. It's better to start simple and then evolve it. So this is the reason. Even these Formula One teams with big budgets, you can see that they started with a simple front wing, so they can understand and then evolve it. That's what we're going to do next.
Okay, Nick. Great, thank you very, very much. As this is the last session or workshop series, I would want again to thank you all for participating in this workshop, for your questions, for your emails, for your engagement. It was really a pleasure to hold this workshop series, and yes, we are very, very happy. Yes, as Nick mentioned, we have this competition. I think this is really a great chance for you to win very attractive prizes. Our professional training, the first prize will get also this F1 Aero package. I think this one of the books also used at university is a really good introduction to F1 aerodynamics. So you're really, everybody's invited to attend, and you don't have to be an expert to do this competition. It's more about you know, creating a nice image. I think we have all the resources on our website with the video, the step-by-step instructions that you really can very quickly have a good result. And if you have any questions, yes, just write us an email. Yes, again, thank you very much. Thank you, Nick. I hope you enjoyed the workshop series. Yes, and I hope to see you on one of our next workshops. Goodbye.
Thank you, Milad. Goodbye, everyone, and we enjoyed it. So thanks, SimScale, and I'm sure we'll do more with you guys in the future. So keep following. Bye-bye. Yes.